Good morning. I'm Joyce Ann Porter, and I am a member of the Comm Server Development Team. I've spent several years working with our Intrusion Detection Services function, and will be presenting some information about that today. I would like to thank Lynn Overby for the slide deck that I will be using. The presentation is going to start off with an overview of IDS, and then we'll move into looking at intrusion events that can be detected by Comm Server, actions that can be taken, and we'll touch on reports and automation. There is a large section, about 20 or so slides at the end, that deal with working with IDS policy. Time permitting, we will go through a piece of that. There is a default IDS policy that's provided by the configuration assistant, and we'll take a look at that if we have time today. So, starting at the beginning, what is the intrusion threat? So what is an intrusion? It can be a wide variety of things. It can be something such as information gathering, determining what's in your network and system topology. It could be eavesdropping, impersonation, theft. It could be a denial of service, a single packet that crashes a server, allowing then users not being able to get into it, a multiple attack packet that blocks legitimate traffic. So it's a wide category of things that can be classified as intrusions. Now, the attack, of course, can be deliberate, but it could also be unintentional in the form of errors in network nodes that end up causing, say, some sort of a denial of service attack. And the final point on this slide is that the attacks can occur, of course, from the internet, but they can also originate from the intranet. The firewall that is providing your perimeter security may not be sufficient if there are concerns with intranet attacks as well as internet. The picture on this slide is taking us through some of the components involved in Comm Server's intrusion detection services. And starting at the left-hand corner, we see that the configuration assistant can be involved in providing a mechanism for configuring your IDS policy. Policy agent then reads the policy and installs it into the TCP/IP stack. Once it's installed, the stack will make the appropriate checks and take the actions that you've configured. Those actions fall into two basic categories. It can be a defensive action, such as discarding a packet, limiting connections, or even potentially resetting connections. There are also some reporting actions. And in the diagram, you can see that if, say, an attack is detected, you could have requested that an event message be generated to the MVS console, or an event message could be written to syslog daemon. There's also a separate IDS packet trace, so it looks very, the output is formatted in a manner similar to your regular packet trace, but it's a subset of the packets that are being traced. It's the suspicious packets that would be found in that IDS packet trace. Comm Server's IDS services support is really meant to be complementary to other intrusion detection mechanisms you have in your network. It's meant to complement your firewall that's on the perimeter, or even if you have an IDS device in external to Comm Server that's doing some sort of a evaluation of every packet against a table. That's not what Comm Server's doing. We're doing an integrated approach where, as we're processing packets, we're looking for potential suspicious activity in them. As I mentioned, this is configured via policy. So you go with your basic policy model. You have policy rules that have conditions as part of them. If those conditions are met, we'll take a configured action. Now we'll look at the three basic types of intrusion events that are detected by Comm Server: the scan, attack, and traffic regulation types. So start with scan. We have scan detection and reporting. Now the intent of the scan is to map the target attack. So what does your network look like? What servers may be running? What addresses are in use? Trying to find out about your network in preparation for an attack. So a scan in and of itself is not harmful, but it's that gathering of information by a particular source that is intent on an attack. We also have attack detection, reporting, and prevention. And this is a wide array of different checking that we'll look at in some more detail. And also, traffic regulation is provided for TCP connections and UDP receive queues. And we're going to go into some detail on each of these in the coming slides. So to start with understanding how Comm Server can detect a scan, we want to start with the definition of a scanner. And that definition is that a source host that's accessing multiple unique resources over a specified time period. And some of that information is configurable. So if there's a particular source, and we're looking at particular source IP addresses, and it's looking across, say, your TCP ports to see where you may have a server running, and it's doing this within a certain time period, that's what we're going to be looking for when you enable scan detection. You're able to configure both a fast and a slow scan and activate both of those, or you can just activate a single scan. A fast scan may be a program that is rapidly accessing a number of resources in that short period of time. We also give you the ability not only to look for that, but to go with this slower scan to define a longer interval that access is being determined. The scan event types supported, we can look for TCP port scans, UDP port scans, and ICMP scans. Your scan policy is going to provide the ability to obtain notification and documentation of this scanning activity. And that notification, as we saw in the overall flow, in the overall diagram, that notification can be to the console, to the MVS console, or the syslog D messages. You also have the ability to trace potential scan packets to the IDS trace. You control the parameters that define the scan. There are defaults provided, but you can modify them as needed for your installation and in your network. You control the time interval over which Comm Server will look for the scan events, and you control the threshold number of scan events that are considered within that time interval to be a scan. There are a couple of mechanisms to help reduce the level of false positives. One is to provide an exclusion list. When you configure this IDS scan and try it out, it's possible you're going to find that you have a network management application in your network that is legitimately scanning your network. Well, you don't want to get scan detection messages for that resource. So there's the ability to exclude that resource as a legitimate scanner. And there's also a sensitivity level, which we'll take a look at in, I believe it's the next slide. Yes. So how does this scan work? And we're going to get into the details on this slide of how this scan works. Each scan event that occurs, and let me give you an example of a scan event. There's a connection request to a particular server, and the connection request is made, a send packet is received, and we reply, never hear anything else again. It times out. That timeout would be considered a very suspicious scan event. Now, on its own, it may not actually be any kind. It may be totally unrelated to a scan. So we're looking across a number of events to determine if there's a scan going on. I did want to point out that in the IP configuration guide, there is some detailed classification information as to how we classify events as normal, suspicious, or very suspicious. And then this is where your scan sensitivity comes in that it determines what we count against that scan threshold. So you're able to have a sensitivity of, say you have a sensitivity level of high in your policy. Well, we're going to count from a particular source IP address, we're going to count normal events, possibly suspicious events, very suspicious events. Everything's going to be counted in determining if we have enough events within the period of time configured to be considered a scan. If you are using a high level of sensitivity and you're finding that you're getting false positives, it may make sense to go to the low sensitivity where only very suspicious events are counted, or possibly medium where possibly and very suspicious events are counted. So the countable scan events count against an origin source IP address. And that total number of scan events is compared to the policy thresholds. And then the notification is provided that a scan has occurred. So I'll move on into the attacks against the TCP/IP stack. And one point I want to make is that ComServer already, regardless of any IDS policy you have configured or not configured, will silently defend itself from many attacks against the TCP/IP stack. The TCP/IP stack, as it's processing packets, it's going to be making lots of checks on them, regardless of whether you have IDS configured or not. It's going to validate lengths. It's going to look at fields to make sure they have valid values. If they don't, we don't continue processing that packet. It's discarded. So that protection is always there. Now, IDS, in those particular cases, adds the capability to control the recording or the notification of the intrusion events, and also to provide supporting documentation, whether it's an IDS trace or messages. The IDS function also does give you control to detect and disable uncommon or unused features, which could be used in an attack. So, for example, the TCP/IP protocol provides protocols from 0 to 255. So it's a lot of protocol values available. Very few of those are implemented. Only probably a handful of those are actually implemented and used. Some are not defined. Some are experimental. You can use IDS to learn when a protocol, an uncommon or unused protocol, is being used in your network. You can choose whether you want to discard that or whether you just want to be notified of it. But that's some of the IDS attack processing does give you the ability to do that as well. Now we come to the chart with lots of attack categories. I want to go through some of these in a little bit of detail here. Some have slides later. We'll focus on maybe some of the ones that have been added more recently. ComServer has had IDS support since V1R2, and a number of additional support was added in V1R13. So we'll take a look at a couple of these. One, I had mentioned the malformed packet events, and this is, again, a packet that has a bad length, a bad value, anything like that. These we're discarding already without IDS. When you turn on IDS, you get notification. I'll mention the inbound fragment restrictions because this is one that we have had an update to recently, actually in V2R1. TCP/IP provides a very flexible mechanism for using fragments, and they can be used because of the flexibility of the standards for fragments. they can be used in attacks. Our earlier, prior to V2R1, our IDS fragment restriction checks, we're trying to find a really small fragment that was unexpected, that was suspicious. In V2R1, we were able to add some more sophisticated checking, which will actually look for overlays and fragments that are changing the packet contents. So you have three fragments. Fragment 1 and 2 have some of the same, fragment 2 overlays fragment 1 and actually changes the data. And so that is an enhancement to our IDS fragmentation that's relatively new. Several of these others, such as the protocol restrictions and the option restrictions, are the ones that I was mentioning earlier, where there's really only a handful of values that are in common use, and you may want to be aware when other values, other options or protocols are in use in your network. You may want to actually discard them and not allow them. Several of these other newer ones are covered in more detail on our additional slides, so I'm going to move on to the next slide. The whole list of attack categories we saw, they can be controlled independently. You can enable them all. You can enable one of them or any subset. You can actually specify separate notifications for each of them if you want. So very flexible. You can also have a common set of notification. One thing I do want to mention is that the Configuration Assistant provides a fairly robust default policy for IDS, a requirement map, and it includes enabling all of the attack categories basically with just reporting, not with any defensive actions. So that is a place where you would, if you do not have IDS configured and you would like to give it a try, that's a good place to start to take that requirement map and make modifications or try it out and see how that, see what you find out in your network with that. So the attack policy does allow you to generate notification. And there also are statistics associated with this. There's both some summary and detailed statistics. And then there are defensive actions with the attack. So in cases where the fragment attack we talked about, for ComServer to make that check, that fragmentation check, you would need to enable IDS checking, and then you, based on your action, we'll either notify you about it or potentially discard it if you have specified that you want that a suspicious packet that falls into that fragment check to be discarded. Okay, we're going to go into several of the other attack types. The interface flood is one that falls under the flood category, and we have several slides on this just to provide a basic understanding of what this is doing. So a packet discard rate by physical interface is tracked to determine if there's a potential attack. So when you turn on your flood detection, ComServer will begin to look at the rate of packet discards by interface. And a high percentage of discarded packets on a physical interface could be indicative that an interface is under attack. There's notification traces provided with this, and it also is providing information to help you determine the cause of that interface flood. It's narrowing the fact that we're discarding all of these packets that are coming over this local interface. You could take an action, and this is a manual action, not an action that that ComServer would take for you, but you could take an action to vary the interface offline. There's also some information to try to help you work your way back to the source of the attack. So we're going to have an example on the next slide, but let's go through the policy-related information and how this works. So you turn on the flood detection, and you have two values that you can configure. The defaults are also provided. And one is a minimum discard rate. So I don't even want to look for an interface flood until I've hit discarding 1,000 packets over this interface. That's the default. And then I only want to consider it an interface flood if that 1,000 packets is at least 10% of my traffic. So for each interface, we're tracking this by interface, counts are kept for the number of inbound packets that arrived over the physical interface and also the number that are discarded. When we hit that discard, that minimum discard value, if that number of discards occurred within 1 minute or less, we're going to calculate the rate, and if the rate exceeds the configured percentage, an interface flood condition exists, and it's going to be reported through the notification means. Now, if your minimum discard is 1,000 and it took 5 minutes before that happened, it's not going to be considered a flood condition. We're not even going to look for a rate with that. Once an interface flood is detected on a particular interface, we're going to start collecting some more granular data about what is being discarded, and we're going to evaluate on a 1 minute interval what's going on. Do we still seem to be in this interface flood? Do we still seem to have this large percentage of packets being discarded? And we won't exit this checking, this interface flood checking, until we get to half of the specified threshold, or if we don't reach the discard rate during that 1 minute interval, then we would also exit the interface flood. So we're going to take a look at an example here. So assume that we have these values configured. So we have a minimum discard of 2,000 and a percentage of 10%. And we're looking at interface X. So we'll take a look line by line and see what the interface flood checking is doing for us. So when we hit the discard count of 2,000, we look to see how long did it take us to count to 2,000 discards. In this case, it was greater than a minute. So since it took longer than a minute, we don't go any further. We reset the counters and start again. We then continue to count discards. And the next time we hit 2,000, in this example, it took less than a minute to hit 2,000. So we take a look and say, well, what is the rate of discards? Is 2,000 a large percentage of our traffic, or is it something negligible? So the percentage in that case, given the inbound count, is 6.6%. That's less than our 10%. So again, we don't consider that an interface flood is ongoing. On the third line in this sequence for interface X, we again hit 2,000. It's in under a minute, and we calculate the rate. It's now 10%. So we detect an interface flood and provide notification that an interface flood has started. We begin running that 1 minute timer until the flood end is detected. And so now in our chart, we're not looking based on the discard count anymore. We're looking every minute. So 1 minute later, we take a look. The discard count is 3,000. We've had 40,000 packets come in. We look at the rate. It's 7.5%. Well, that's less than our 10%, but we're not actually going to exit the flood condition until we get to at least half of the configured percentage. So the interface flood condition continues. A message is issued with this that provides some specific information about the types of things that are being discarded. We don't keep track of that specific information until an interface flood is detected initially, and once it is, then we start keeping track and providing information about what's being discarded. And then on the final line, the next minute that occurs, we look and we've now have a discard rate of 5%. That is half of our 10%, so we exit the interface flood. We consider that the interface flood has ended. But then we go back to monitoring the interface as we did at the beginning. Okay, let's move on to the next slide. We have several slides here that are dealing with attack types that we added support for in V1R13, and we'll just go into them briefly. The data hiding protection. So the structure of protocol headers can allow hidden data to be embedded. We have a couple of checks that we have added for that. One has to do with ICMP error messages. An ICMP error message should include the packet, the source packet, that it is in response to. So we will do some checking to ensure that the embedded packet looks like an embedded packet. It does match up with what you would expect. If it doesn't, we'll consider that a hidden message and can provide notification or potentially discard the packet if that has been configured to do that. The second check we make has to do with the IPv4 and IPv6 option padding that's done. The padding is expected to have a value of 0. If that padding ends up having a non-zero value, then that's considered suspicious and this check will fail. Again, you have the ability to do notification or to actually have the packets discarded, or both. So I'll move on to the TCP queue size protection. And we've got a couple of attacks here that are dealing with the TCP queue. This one looks at the send queue, the receive queues, and out of order queues. And it's looking for them to become constrained. Now, there's some protection provided regardless of IDS that after a certain number of seconds, that the data is going to be marked page eligible. So that's not related, that's regardless of IDS. However, you're able to get some notification through IDS, and you can also potentially be able to reset a constrained connection as well. Now, this is focused on individual TCP connections, not across individual ones, regardless of what else is going on in the network. On the next slide, we look at something that's looking at similar types of resources, in that it's looking at the TCP send queue, but it's looking across the TCP IP stack at what's going on with TCP connections. So this is designed, this global TCP stall protection is designed to protect against denial of service attacks where a large number of TCP connections are created and then immediately forced to stall. So they're unable to send some large amount of data. So it's consuming a lot of TCP IP resources. To be able to detect this across the stack, we have a criteria for a single connection being considered stalled. Now, it is possible that a single connection would be stalled and then become unstalled, and that could happen in the normal course of events. However, we're not concerned here with what's going on with just one, but what's going on overall. So with this, we're looking to see if you have a large number of TCP connections that are in a stalled state. So we'll enter this global TCP stall condition when there are at least 1,000 TCP connections active. So if you just have a few connections, we're not looking for a problem at that point with a global stall and using up resources. And at least 50% of those connections are in a stalled state. And you have the ability to specify that you want reporting about this. In this, we provide a basic and a detailed reporting. You will need to be careful with detailed reporting because it's giving you a message per connection that's stalled. So you can tell from the math up here that could be 500 messages or more that all coming in. There is also a defensive action that you can reset connections. And what this will do is, if a global TCP stall is detected, it will reset all the stalled connections. It's possible that you may have some legitimate connections in there that are going to get reset, along with others, the attack connections. But that is a defensive action that can be taken, and it certainly doesn't have to be taken. You can just go with the reporting type option. So the next slide does a little bit of a comparison between those two, since they're both dealing with the TCP queues. It's pointing out the differences basically between the fact that this is dealing with an attack of an individual TCP queue, where the global TCP stall is looking for something across the system. The lines I want to point out here are that the TCP queue size attack is detected after at least 30 or 60 seconds. So if we're going to take an action for a particular TCP connection, we want to wait an appropriate amount of time for the condition to clear. If you had TCP queue size attack configured and didn't have the global TCP stall attack configured, then you might think, well, you know, after 30 or 60 connections, this condition would be detected on each of these TCP connections, and that it could be reset at that point. However, the attack detection for the global TCP stall, it's not going to be based on time. So as quickly as that flood of connections comes in and stalls, we can detect that much more quickly than the 30 seconds where we would have to wait for each connection. We would be able to detect that the overall system had this condition going on. On the flip side, if you're just using the global TCP stall attack, it's only going to be triggered when there's large number of connections stalled, it would miss if there were just one or two or a small number of connections stalled. And the TCP queue size attack is geared to look at them individually. The next category, in V1R13, we added some attack types that were specific to EE. So EE, or Enterprise Extender, is based on UDP, and it uses 5 predefined ports, typically the ones listed here. The other IDS checking that we have been talking about is focused on this IP header, and in this case a UDP header, this beginning information. The EE attack types are going to add additional checking of the EE headers that are embedded within the TCP/IP packet. I'm not going to go through those individually, but I did want to point out that we have added some that are specific to EE. Okay, so we've made it through the attack detection. We've looked at scan, we've looked at attack, now traffic regulation. So we have 2 flavors of that: traffic regulation for TCP and for UDP. So we're going to take a look at TCP. We have few slides here and an example. So this function allows you to control the number of inbound connections from a single host. And that can be specified for specific application ports, or if you have multiple applications using the same port, it can be per application. the connection limit is going to be expressed as a port limit for all connecting hosts. So you have a particular server, you're going to set a limit for the number of connections that you can have for that server using that port. And then there's also an individual limit for any one single connecting host. And the thing to realize about this is that there's no distinction between connecting hosts with the traffic regulation for TCP. It's any connecting host is going to have this individual limit applied. The way this works is it's basically a fair share algorithm. So we'll allow the connection. Connection request comes in. That's when we use the TCP traffic regulation to decide if we're going to allow that connection. And it's going to be allowed if the specified individual limit per single remote IP address does not exceed the percentage of available connections for the port. We're going to look at an example to really understand what that means, but one key piece to that is we're looking against at the available connections for the port, not the total connections that we configured, but the available connections. And one other point on this slide is that this is a fair share algorithm. Every source that's trying to connect into the server is treated the same. If you have a need to allow a particular client, particular source, to override this fair share algorithm, it needs to be able to get X number of connections, regardless of how many are available, then there is a QoS connection limit that can be used to override this. So we'll have an example on the next slide, but before we look at that, we need to get several of the pieces defined as to what we have, how we look at this traffic regulation for TCP connections. So we start off with a configured maximum allowed connections for a given port. That's then divided into the in-use connections, so how many connections from however many hosts, but how many connections are in use, and how many are available. Then within the in-use connections, we're also keeping track of the connections from a given source IP address. And finally, there's this configured controlling percentage, which provides the mechanism for how many connections an individual host is able to get. So if a new connection request is received, and we don't have any available connections, that's pretty straightforward. The request is rejected. So your total number of available connections is enforced. If a new connection request is received, and we do have available connections, and it's from a source that already has connections with this port number, then we need to take a look and say, well, how many connections does it have now? And does that fit within the amount that our controlling percentage says that it can have of the available connections? So you can see the algorithm there. I'm going to go to the next slide and we'll look at an example because that becomes much clearer. But I do want to point out this purpose here. If you're close to the connection limit, here we've got quite a few available connections. As this moves over and we have less and less available connections, then any given source IP address is going to be restrained in how many connections it can that are allowed with that particular port. So, in our example, source IP address X is attempting its fifth connection. So it already has four connections with this port. It's attempting a fifth connection. And we'll look at A. If we currently have 40 connections available. So in this chart, the total allowed is 100. That was configured. There's 60 in use. We have 40 available. Our controlling percentage that was configured is 20%. So given that we have 40 available and the controlling percentage of 20, any one host can have up to 8 connections. We're trying to get our fifth, that's less than 8, So we would allow the connection. If that connection came in at that point in time when we had 40 connections available, that connection would be allowed. Now, the key here is the fact that we're looking at the available connections. So if source IP address X attempted its fifth connection at a point where we only had 20 available connections, then when we apply the controlling percentage to that 20, then this host is only allowed 4 connections. So when it's attempting a fifth connection, that's going to be rejected. So it's important to understand that that controlling percentage is applied to the available connections, and that available connection, of course, is always a changing value. I do want to say, though, that we don't go back and say, oh, okay, you have more than 4, you can't, you know, we're going to take them away. That doesn't happen. It's just looking at the point when you make a connection request, are we going to allow it, or are we going to reject it? The traffic regulation for UDP is really completely different. We're not looking at connections for a server. We're looking at the inbound receive queues. And even with no IDS, you have a profile parameter, UDP queue limit, and no UDP queue limit, that allows you to limit all your queues so that no more than 2,000 packets can be queued at any one time on a UDP receive queue. That's across the board. It's a global parameter. What IDS is going to do for you is it's going to allow you to, you can still use UDP queue limit, but you can also specify rules that will say, for this UDP application, say for the Ike daemon, I want to allow a larger or smaller inbound receive queue. And so you're able to provide rules specified on a per port basis that will take precedence over this global UDP queue limit. Now, if neither the TR UDP or the UDP queue limit is used, then a stalled application or a flood against a single UDP port could consume a lot of available storage. So in most cases, you would want to be using at least one of these mechanisms. Now, the TR UDP queue limit is expressed as short, very short, long, and very long. The IP configuration guide provides some information about what those values are. I'll tell you that long is basically the same as the UDP queue limit of 2,000, and very long is around 8,000. So we've covered scan, attacks, and traffic regulation. We'll take a quick look at IDS actions that we've mentioned throughout, but take a look at that. And we noted that they can be classified either as recording or notification actions or defensive actions. So the recording actions are event logging to syslogd, event logging to the MVS console. There's also statistics provided. Those go to syslogd. There is the IDS packet trace. And one thing to note in the syslog and console messages is that there's a probe ID and a correlator. Now, the probe ID is going to identify a specific place or a specific check that was made that caused this event to be detected. And in our SNAN IP codes publication, there is a chapter that lists all the probe IDs and a kind of a one-liner description of the condition that was detected that caused this. This is probably most interesting in some of the attacks, the malformed attacks, to understand, you know, what exactly did we see in the packet or what area were we looking at when we found the problem and decided to discard this packet. And the correlator field is going to allow you to correlate data. If you have a syslog message and an MVS console message and some trace data, and you want to correlate those events together, that provides that ability. As far as defensive actions by the different event types, we've talked a lot about packet discard. There's also the ability for some of them to reset the connection, and we mentioned that as well in those attack types that are geared towards the TCP queues. The scan events don't really have a defensive action defined. We're looking for a group of packets that are scanning your network. We're not able to say this particular packet is a bad packet and we need to drop it. And then traffic regulation events, there's connection limiting there on the TCP TR. You either allow a connection or disallow connection. And one thing I may not have made clear is that with TCP TR and the UDP TR, you do have the defensive actions, but you also can use those initially with a notification only policy. So you can say, well, my FTP server, I want to say that it can have this many total connections, and I don't want any one source to be able to have more than 10% of the connections at any time. And you can not specify defensive action, so you don't specify that you want to limit it to that. Instead, you just specify that you want to be notified, and then you'll receive messages that indicate that this connection would have been denied. And that is a reasonable way to start working with the TCP TR policy. And the IP configuration guide in the IDS chapter, the TCP traffic regulation section, does talk some about the steps that you may want to go through as you are looking to set up a TCP TR policy. As far as defensive actions, the ones we've been talking about are ones you configure in your IDS policy. But CompServer also offers a defensive filtering function. And this can be used as an extension to your IDS capabilities. Basically, we have a defense manager component that allows authorized users to dynamically install time-limited defensive filters. So these are filters that are going to drop packets. They're not meant to be your overall everyday IPsec policy, but you're able to install these for a period, I believe it's up to 2 weeks, to react quickly to an attack. It's possible that if there is a message that is received from an IDS attack, that you understand that when that message is seen, that a particular filter needs to be put in. It's possible to do that kind of coordination using the defensive filter processing. Then we're going to look at some reports. Just in general, I mentioned there's the TRMD stack command, a ZOS Unix command, that can take your syslogd data and provide a summary report or a detailed report or a statistics report. And so if you're using IDS, you're using syslog, you're recording events in syslogd, this is worth looking at to see how those reports might help you. And Tivoli support for IDS events. So Tivoli NetView, if you're using NetView in your network, provides local ZOS management support for IDS. So they're able to trap IDS messages either from the MVS console or syslogd and then take predefined actions. And some of these actions can be to route the IDS messages to NetView consoles, to email notifications, to perhaps run the TRMD stat report and attach it to an email. And it also is able to issue predefined commands. So that's another option for adding on to the overall IDS support. So I have gone down to page 45 in the display and am taking a look at the default policy that's provided by Configuration Assistant for IDS. So basically, you may have different levels of familiarity with the Configuration Assistant. These slides are as of 2.1 on ZOSMF. The Configuration Assistant provides is a requirement map, and then that requirement map can be tied into a particular TCP/IP stack. So the requirement map that they provide, the default one, as I mentioned earlier, and you can see here, it's enabling all of the different attack types. It doesn't enable by default scan or traffic regulation because those require some network-specific types of settings. But it does enable all of the attack types, and there is some attack types, it's just simply a matter of enabling them. Other attack types, you have to do some definition, and so they provide some good starting definition for those. In this particular case, you can see under actions, all of them say report events, except for a couple such as the malformed, which say both drop and report. The reason they say drop and report is because we're always going to drop malformed packets. You can't stop the TCP/IP stack from dropping them. But basically, if you put this policy on, it's not going to cause anything to be discarded that wasn't already being discarded, say with the malformed packets. So it's a way of kind of starting out and taking a look at IDS on your system. You'll see the default report settings. In this particular case, the settings that are turned on are the same for all the attack types. There's just one report setting, and they do not have NVS console messages turned on. They do have syslog messages turned on, do have statistics being kept on a 60-minute interval, and they don't have IDS trace turned on. So that's just the default. You certainly could copy the default requirement map and start making modifications. You may want to start making modifications in the default report settings. Then on the next slides, and I'm looking at this view details view, which allows you to see exactly what's configured. Now, if you were configuring your own policy, you could look at what you have configured. This is allowing us to look at some specifics about the default policy. And one thing I wanted to point out here, let's take a look at we'll look at this IPv6 destination option attacks. Basically, this attack requires you to provide a list of restricted options. And what the Configuration Assistant has done here is evaluated, okay, options can be from 0 to 255. What are the defined options? And what's reserved? If an option is reserved, we don't really expect to see that. And so all of those are restricted. So it gives you a set of definitions that give you common protocols, common options, without you having to go and investigate that on your own. So that's a very helpful piece of this default policy. And that continues on through each of the different attack types. We see there's several pages of that. Then you'll see in the default requirement map that there isn't any scan protection turned on or any traffic regulation turned on. But as I said, you would start with the default requirement map, make a copy of that, and then begin adding to that. We can take a look. I'm going to move down to where the scan policy is on page 54 to just show you a little bit about what that looks like. You'll see that there are various tabs, the attack policy, scan policy, traffic regulation. So when you're on the scan tab, you're able to click enable scan, and then you will get a few defaults here that you would be able to choose if you wanted to. There's your sensitivity that we talked about. And then there's also circled down here is the modify fast and slow scan settings. So if we go to the next page, we'll see here that there are some default values. The fast scan interval here is defined as 1 minute with how many accesses within that to indicate that there's a scan, and that's 5. And similarly, you can enable a slower scan and have a longer period of time and the same or more events. So that's a sample of how the scan looks to configure. For the traffic regulation, again, you would select the tab, traffic regulation. You would enable it. And in this particular case, I'm going down to slide 58, you're going to have to understand what servers, using what ports, you want to protect with traffic regulation. One tip is that you don't want to just give it the whole range of ports and say, oh, protect everything. That causes some storage issues, and it doesn't make sense to be trying to use TCP traffic regulation for something like an FTP data connection, which is short-lived. You want this to be your server type connection, such as your FTP server. So I think that's all that I was going to cover today. You have a number of slides that do go through a step-by-step of the configuration assistant. This is, again, the V2R1 configuration assistant on ZOSMF. So I believe that's all for me.